Where's my sunglasses?
Where do I know you from, David? I never forget a face.
I'm one of the most forgotten faces in Hollywood.
Nah.
Really?
I never forget a face.
Damn, that sounds like me.
Showbiz stuff.
He's rolling. He's bloody rolling on me.
Do we know what he's saying?
I said, I love you, honey, back to the camera while y'all were talking.
I'm going to make sure my zip's done up. Okay. That belt's a little loose. Hang on a minute. I'm trying to impress casting agents.
It's an interesting coupling because in some ways...
There was no coupling. There was no coupling. No,
at least they're not in the movie. But seriously, folks. But one of you is pretty much you, and one of you is an actor. Or more of a professional, traditional actor.
That's a true story. It is, isn't it? Yep.
I'm a surgeon. That's a professional.
I know, but your personality.
Oh, well, yeah, well, that's been me forever.
You're kind of a natural personality. So was there a bonding that was required? Was there a thought about this in the process?
Oh, yes. Right in front of my freezer at home, opened up the mason jar and introduced him to moonshine, drinking right out of the jar. Okay.
I was in shell shock. We shot for a weekend. You know, Martha hates me when I say this shit, right? But... can you imagine you come from an acting background and you're there and you're confronted with Earl Lynn, right? And it's like a Sherman tank, right, in your living room. And you don't know what the fuck is going on, right?
That's 17 times today you said the F word.
It blew my mind how big this guy is, right? And so you, how do you form a character when all of the vacuum is already full? Right? So you have to find a place for Colin to fit into this, right? Mm-hmm. So really, I mean, Earl Lynn, I've realized lately, I think Earl Lynn or Mitch formed Colin. Colin was like his alter ego, which is why they got on so well. But it was really, it was, the shoot itself was brutal. And Kentucky, as I said, blew my mind because it was like, whoa. And it's the more I think about it, the more I realize the dynamics of what happened in the film, right, and why it worked.
So was it mind-blowing for you, Earl Lynn, or you just figured that you're going with it, go with the flow and...
Martha called me up and said, would you want to go to Iceland for a month? And I said, yeah. That was it, you know.
And from there, is the script difficult for you?
They wrote the script after that Paul and I said we'd do it. Mm-hmm. They didn't write the script beforehand.
But is the script so tailored to you that it just comes naturally to you, or is it actually... because Paul obviously is more experienced reading a script.
We would like to say that, till we do the numbers again, I'm so tired.
Let's not do the numbers. No,
God, I hate to do the numbers. God, people ask us that all the time. Let's put it like this. We molded the script to fit the things it needed to do that Aaron and Martha wanted us to do to make the movie work.
There was a script.
We had a script. Hmm. We had a script. Mm-hmm.
But see, Martha has grown up with Earl Lynn. So Martha,
and I are first cousins.
I think someone said, you know, Martha has Earl Lynn's voice when she's writing for him, and that made okay, Martha. See, I say stuff, and Martha goes, "Paul, why did you say that? Why did you say that about me?" But when we're shooting the car scenes, mm-hmm. and the references to phallic symbols and all this sort of stuff, right? Either Martha or Aaron are in the back of the
Hummer, truck while we're driving.
Saying, hey, Earl Lynn, try, when you say lighthouse, try saying, right, they remind you of rock hard cocks, right?
With no balls.
With no balls, right? So, and this would come over from the back of the thing. We would play that, right? And it was like, okay. And I, you know, there's one lovely bit of improv which came from me, but it just works so beautifully.
Oh, excuse me.
He asked me a question about something in the car, and I say something like, I'm afraid to ask. It's funny as hell. I really like, you can pick the little improv bits that you know you that were just there that works there really well for the scene.
So you mentioned that he had said the F word a number of times already today.
And today.
It says on the press notes that you watch Hallmark Channel movies, and yet your dialogue in this movie suggests otherwise. The F word is a casual friend, and that you know you would watch R-rated movies. Is that part of it that's not you?
F word is something that my mother despised. Okay, I mean, any other words you wanted to use was not a problem.
Okay, so the rock hard cock, no problem.
Oh,
the F word.
It's funny, you know, he doesn't swear, and he always censures me when I
see.
When
the thing about it is, when did you see the movie, David?
A couple days ago.
Okay. You remember the Black Beach scene when the wave gets him wet, mm-hmm. and it flashes over. It looks, see this big black rock sticking out of the water. Mm-hmm. Did that look like anything familiar that you might have known?
Okay. Well, not personally. But
well, okay. Sure in Iceland, not. in Iceland, they call that Dick Rock.
Not Richard.
Nope.
Not Richard.
Dick Rock.
Richard Rock.
Okay. But I'm not a cursor. I have, as you know, sayings that I have that have been around with me for years. Mm-hmm. Like angels pissing on your tongue. That's I coined that back when I was a teenager, you know, and various little sayings like that, you know.
And is your general take towards women similar to the one we saw in the film?
I love women. My grandma told me, said Easy, that was my nickname when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. Said Easy, always be nice to the ladies, and they'll always be nice to you. And guess what? That's been my philosophy my whole life.
You get some good philosophy in the movie, good advice in the movie in this regard.
Yes.
Here's your one chance, fancy, don't let me down.
What about that? Everybody thought I was going to say something nasty to that guy.
Yes. You know?
Just remember, she's always right.
Yeah.
No matter what, she's always right.
Yeah. Well, I met your wife at the inside earlier.
Annie? Yeah.
She seems like she's got a pretty good swing there.
Oh, she's good.
She's a strong woman.
Yes, she sure is. She works hard.
So is it Laurel and Hardy? Is that the, are you the Stan Laurel to his Hardy? Are you the, I mean, is that where you had
that's
to go?
That's another fine mess you guys in.
gracious.
You know.
Are you the
no,
teacher
no,
to his
I
friend?
Don't think so. I don't think so. I didn't mentally prepare Colin at all for that. He just is who he is. I mean, who else could Colin have been? You know, and unless he was an ordinary old person.
But I don't think he would have liked you as much.
You wouldn't have liked it. You know, if Colin had been like this really, really nasty piece of work, then that wouldn't have worked at all. So really, Colin formed with the script development and with the way it was shot and storyline, and he was just who he is. Which is, you know, it's kind of a gift to be able to do that. And again, who else could he could not have been a big loudmouth,
right.
A funny guy. It wouldn't have worked at all.
So when you landed in Iceland, was it you still thrilled to be there for a month? Was it immediate? Was it a love relationship, or was it iffy place for you guys? Or
it's a beautiful place. I fell in love with it.
People are wonderful. The food is tolerable. It's very expensive there since the government went down the tubes, you know, bankrupt and so forth. But the people speak better English than we do. And their people are really nice and friendly. You know, they were.
Especially on Friday nights.
At the low. At that, how many bars in the Reykjavik, they're open two nights a week, Friday, Saturday. They're not open any other time. And they make enough money those two nights. To make a living for all the people who worked there for a whole week.
Yeah, I was talking to a local, and he said, I walked home from a karaoke bar. We did karaoke one. I just walked home all the way from there to the hotel through the main street. And I passed about 20 places with music and people. And I was talking to a local. I said, what's that about? Because he said, well, Friday nights we all celebrate. We all go out. We all make love. And then on Saturday, we all go back, and well, they're very reserved people. You know, they're not outwardly huge people. They're very reserved. But on Friday nights, they get hammered, and they have fun, and they enjoy themselves. Right? It's really, really, they're lovely people. It's like they all had the same parents. Mm. You know, the men all look like they had one father, and the women all look like they had one mother. It's unusual.
So Aaron and Martha said that the kind of the ritual once you guys started shooting was to come to you guys with the next day's pages every night to discuss what you thought and what they thought and what the plan was and all of that.
Yep.
Yep.
So how'd that work for you? Was that?
I think it was great because the script, the idea of the script, you could read it and see what you want, but the way it was written wouldn't be the way I would say it. Mm-hmm. And so they'd say, well, how would you say it? And I'd say, because if it got the point across, that's all they wanted to have happen. But in my terms, in my words, if you will. And they'd say, well, this is the way we want to get across, you know, in this next scene. Mm-hmm. Because it was tough. We didn't shoot the movie 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Right. You know, we here. And there was a lot of times that, you know, that we would come out, we'd get ready to say something and say, oh my goodness, that hadn't happened yet. So we can't talk about it. We can't bring that up because it hadn't happened yet in the movie, you know? So that was tough.
So was there a lot of things unsaid? I mean, was part of it things that, I mean, I think particularly for your character, Paul, were there things where less dialogue was better for you?
Facial expressions. I don't know if you noticed it in the movie or not. To me, I thought the facial expressions were very good.
That's a fucking question. Fuck's sake.
Yeah, but I tell you what, we've done the Martin Bonner theme all damn day today, okay? Let's talk about our movie, okay?
Martin Bonner.
Martin Bonner this and Martin Bonner that. I'm glad I ain't seen the damn movie yet.
Martin Bonner won the John Cassavetes Award at the Indie Spirit Awards. Did you know that?
Okay, how much did that cost you?
Anyway, to answer your question, David, thank you. What was?
I don't remember anymore. I don't
yeah, you know, I. Oh God, I was just quoted because I was nominated for the Stranger Genius Awards. One of three people in Seattle who have actually been nominated for this award, which actually involves getting cash
people
too.
People live in Seattle, 5 or 10.
And so when did you meet for the first time in Kentucky?
To answer your question.
Oh, so remember the question. Okay, we can go back.
Oh God.
You gotta, you know, like words are meaningless if the face on the screen doesn't actually convince you that he believes what he's doing or and believes in what he's saying. So I think that minimalism and stripping it down until you're down to the purity of whatever you're doing, that's important.
Least words and facial expressions, I think, are really, really, you know, very, very, very good communications situations, you know.
So your first meeting of each other was in Kentucky?
Yep.
When you were going to shoot the little
thing, yep.
Segment,
yeah.
The front section?
Yep.
So did you spend any time together with the intention of figuring out how the relationship
would work?
We made
ramp soup.
And they stayed at my house for 3 nights.
Yeah, and, Friday, Saturday, Friday, Sunday, or something.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and drank moonshine, and we cooked, and we had, you know.
He's a rager. Like, I had to lock my bedroom door so I could get some sleep. He's coming and saying, come on, let's have some more moonshine here. I don't want to sleep. Let me sleep. I'm working. I'm here to work.
Did you do a Paul imitation to go with his imitation of you?
Paul, he can't imitate me. Are you kidding me?
He can't imitate me. You
see
kidding
that?
Me?
See what I mean? Golly. I can be a bloke if you'd like me to be a bloke, but I can't get my nose hairs up my nose far enough, okay?
That is so pathetic.
My nose hairs are a little farther up there. I could do a little better on this bloke.
You're going to die.
That's right.
So how long was it between Kentucky and going to Iceland?
May, June, July, August, September, about 6 months.
So was it like a reunion of old friends when you met up again in Iceland? Was that where you saw each other
next?
Well,
I tell you, I promise you, it was amazing. To me, there's my little Paulie, you know. He was still nice. Okay.
Fuck. You know, here's it's really, this is ego, right? When I'm shooting,
admitted his ego. You heard that, huh?
I am used to dominating, right? I mean, I'm an alpha actor, right? I do the subtle parts, but at the same time, I'm like, I'm on fucking set here, right? Not with this guy. It's like I'm over in the corner hiding. I'm just going to freaking shit on the... Keep the input.
I got to go get him out of the corner to give him some more moonshine. Get out of the corner. Come on over here and play with the
big
boys.
Yeah, it's like, you know, Earl Lynn is Earl Lynn, and it's like, don't you know it, all right?
So you finished in October in Iceland.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you know you were going to Sundance or thought you were going to Sundance at the end of it? Or
I had no idea. I had no idea.
They didn't tell you.
He might want to lie, but I didn't know anything.
Well, I talked to some of the guys earlier, and I said, look, they said, why did you want to work with these two? And I said, because I did my due diligence and I did Google them and I looked at their career paths and I looked at where they went to school and I knew they were friends with Chad Hardigan.
Mm-hmm. Name dropping again. Here we go.
So, you know, and I thought, I want to work with these guys, all right. So, what was the question?
Whether you thought you were going to Sundance.
Yeah, and then
production.
Having, once it was finished and having worked with Earl Lynn, mm-hmm. I knew it was honest, and I knew it had a chance, and I knew that it was time for Aaron and Martha to get a shot at Sundance again. Mm. And I really had, I was waiting for the phone call, right? Except that the year before, Chad rang me on my birthday and said, hey, we're at Sundance, right? But so on my birthday, I'm sitting at home waiting for the phone call, right? But I didn't realize that they'd actually moved the announcement date to the 1st of December or something. But I got the phone call. Mm. I was really confident that it would get there.
It's really interesting that Earl is very quiet when you compliment him.
He was complimenting me?
He was much happier when you were
insulting him. Wait a minute, he was complimenting me?
Are you getting a compliment there?
Oh my goodness, I didn't realize he was complimenting me.
Okay. Enjoy it while you can, buddy.
So you had 3 months apart, and then you came back together at Sundance. Mm-hmm. Was that, again, like a fine family reunion?
Yeah, we lived together.
We lived together. We had a condo. It was fun.
We shared the shitter. We shared the pisser.
There you go.
We showered together. I'm sorry,
didn't play drop the soap, though. I guarantee you that.
And how was the screening? When you had that first screening, had you seen the film at all?
No.
Have you seen anything?
Nothing.
So was it scary, or was it just...
I saw my big, ugly face with all the wrinkles and marks on my face on that big screen. I said, oh, shit, look how old and that old fart is up there anyway. I thought, man, I'm
funny
old,
that,
you know?
Yeah, you do. But I'd already seen Martin Bonner, and Chad was pretty brutal with those close-ups, right?
Yes.
So I kind of... It was faster for me, the let-go thing. Because what you see the first time and... It's like too much because it's like a huge screen and there's your head, right? Mm-hmm. But it wasn't that too bad, and I cried. I cried. There's some scenes in Land
Ho. I cried a couple of times.
Yeah.
I cried probably 3 or 4 times during the movie. Truly cried, and I was so amazed because there was some, a lot of the movie that I liked that was cut, you know, and some of the sound. At a couple of places in the movie, you couldn't hear the dialogue, and that disappointed me, okay? Because I thought some of the best things that were going on weren't there. But guess what? They brought it back, though. They brought it back.
Screenings.
In the next,
New
York, they redid
this,
they put it back together. Mm-hmm. In the scene, us walking along there where the geese and the ducks are, that background talk there about being in a test tube, and you might not be here at all. You might be in a spaceship up here, you know. The waterfalls. Did you hear me say anything at the waterfalls?
I don't recall, honestly.
That's the same.
See there?
Now we've done that shtick before. We do something.
It disappoints the shit out of me. We're standing there. We're looking at the waterfalls, and I say to him,
"You know, you said that. I've said it too many times."
Okay, I see. Did you see
the last
of the Mohegans? You remember the waterfalls and the last of the Mohegans?
I did hear that.
You said you didn't hear it at the waterfall.
Well, I didn't recall hearing it, but now you're telling me exactly what it was.
There's a lot of little things that we said that weren't in the script that to me were really good laughs.
Okay. That one was actually in the script. That was actually written.
Yeah, but it was written after, if you'll remember.
No, I can't remember.
So do you remember, were you surprised how much people laughed and how enthusiastic the audience
screening?
Was when you saw it?
First screening, I was, there was blown a couple away. Spots. The first off-color thing I said was, as you know, is angels pissing on your tongue. And there was the first group of people that we, who was that bunch that was on top of the Sony building up there? Who was that group of people? The Golden Globe?
Oh, the
HRPA?
I don't know.
National Board of Review.
Ah.
Yeah. And they, you know, they just, they laughed their ass off, you know? Mm-hmm.
But the Sundance screening, the first screening at the Library Theater was amazing.
They, you know, they, because I never, didn't know anything about that. Mm-hmm. And they said, well, here's what you're going to do. You're going to see when the movie's over with, you're going to have about, you know, 2/3 of people gonna get up and walk out, and there's gonna be if more come down the front and ask a question. Guess what? There wasn't one asshole left that movie. Every one of them stayed.
A couple of them got on stage.
And that's right. And they asked questions and they asked questions. And I was amazed because of what they told me was going to happen. Mm-hmm. But people stayed. Mm. You know, they gave a standing ovation.
Yeah.
You know,
it was amazing.
After the Q&A even, they gave a standing ovation.
And the Salt Lake City screening was different because I think people who actually go to Sundance or go to Park City are actually auteurs. Mm-hmm. And the people who went to the Sundance screening in Utah, in Salt Lake, I think they were actually locals.
A little more conservative there.
A little more conservative, yeah. And so the laughs were not as strong and raucous. Because I think it was, the references were a little too close to home, and therefore they weren't sure whether they should be laughing, so they didn't, right? Mm-hmm. Instead of just going, hey, that's really funny. Yeah, it was a different vibe altogether. Yeah.
Except my laughing. You know, my laughing was contagious. I don't know if did you laugh when I was laughing? Fart scene in the bed when I was laughing myself to death.
Did laugh at the fart scene.
Okay.
All right. We actually, I set it up with Earl Lynn, but the lines were, hey, are you asleep? And he goes, no. And I lie there for a while, and I said, I turned around, and then they were rolling. I said, do you want to have sex? No one in the room even laughed. Aaron just went, yeah, all right.
And the other thing is, he says, are you sawing any logs? And I said, I'm so tired I couldn't saw a toothpick. And I don't think anybody heard that either.
You know? Yeah, I heard it. I heard the fart, too.
So are you guys ready for the sequel? Is that, have you got plans? You gonna take us on the road?
Land ho, mate.
We can't mention any names or whatever's okay, but we've talked about possible TV series, possible redo, I mean do a number two. Uh-huh. And we're pushing for Australia. And there are some other people pushing for Hawaii, and we hope
Excuse me.
Do it, you know?
I'm crying.
You guys could end up together for the rest of your lives.
Oh, goodness gracious. Bless his heart, his wife.
Yeah, this could be the franchise, the Boomer franchise, right? The only one. And we'd probably, in the end, shoot Land Ho Las Vegas, the trip.
Right. We're in Las Vegas.
We got like Land a nine-piece ensemble of baby boomers, right?
Land
like
Duck Dynasty.
Land Ho, Mud Creek, Kentucky. It'd be pretty good.
And will you guys direct, or will you allow the your directors to come back with you?
No, I would never take this from them.
I think it's tough enough us putting up with each other, less long having to damn direct somebody. You know?
Mind you, you know, I've written and directed, and to tell you what, it's not an easy gig, guys. This is much easier than directing.
So you're going to bring Aaron and Martha along for the ride?
Well, it's their franchise. You know.
Well, they got their, you know, their names on the paper. Yeah. And, of course, they've got, what do you call those things that you hate? Agent.
Yeah, they got what the?
Agents. I don't have one of those either.
You know, I'm going, okay, oh, Aaron's got an agent. I'm going, fuck, Martha's got an agent, right? No.
We're just around the corner from CAA.
This lawyer walks up to me when we're in New York, says, I'm Martha's agent. gives me his card.
And is, have they made the action figures of the two of you?
No. Oh, goodness gracious.
Yeah, with a giant schnauzer.
There you go, baby. There you go.
You actually get to hold him by the genitals. Yeah. Oh, look. Not for kids.
The body stays the same and the genitals rocks back and forth.
Yeah, you know, like it's not a bubble head, it's a bubble penis or something.
Oh, by the way, you need to know that when I found out I was drinking 3-2 beer or 2-3 beer or whatever, mm-hmm. and I say balls at the top of the stairs.
Yeah.
We did that. I did balls, what did it say, 20 sometimes?
20 takes.
20 different highs and lows and loudnesses and so forth of the balls before they picked which one they were going to do.
So now you see what I was working with, right?
Balls are not easy. All
right. This is what I'm working with.
You got to hit the balls just right.
Yes, sir.
That was, yeah, and... yeah, I got to be careful because this is like eternity. We're looking at eternity here. Right?
You are, unfortunately.
Which is why the F word disappeared from my vocabulary right there. Right?
See there? Bless my mom was looking. Thanks, Mom.
And my wife, like, I did a shot. I'm sorry. I did a shot for the stranger in Perth, right? Mm-hmm. And we, you know, like just some stills, some headshots and stuff. And I was talking to the photographer and I said, we were at a park in Bellevue because I'd just done an interview for King 5. Boy, do you like the way I like to segue this?
Wait a minute, anyway. You were aware?
Anyway, I said, let's go in the men's room and we'll shoot. And so I'm standing next to the urinal, right, against the wall like this looking. And my wife just goes, God, oh, bloody mighty, why? I said, because it was different. It was something that no one else had done.
Well, no one else has done this before.
No, we've done, you know, actually we love each other now.
Yep.
Yep.
We don't have to work together anymore.